Good evening.
Where's that camera working?
Good evening, everyone. It's Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training, with one of my weekly What Would Jeff Do podcast. It's Wednesday. Let me just check on my settings here. And what I want you to do is, if you private, you can put all of your questions in the chat box below. And the questions in the chat box below, you ask me a question. Hey, everybody, I'm Meerkat. How are you? Thank you so much for liking and favoriting and retweeting. I really, really appreciate it. If folks on Meerkat are new to me, I've been doing a weekly radio show for 6 years now. It's on every Saturday morning. The What Would Jeff Do show, it's streamed around the world, 86 countries, as well as in our local market in Providence, Rhode Island. I'm going to be drinking coffee and eating snacks, actually, during this webinar. I want you to ask all your dog training questions. You'll get an answer. Folks on Meerkat, you can also ask a question, and I really, really appreciate the folks on Meerkat. Let's see. Someone's asking me something here. There's a request. I can't do any requests to do that. So put your, Lenny asked a question. Lenny, Queenie is almost 8 months old, 50 to 60 pounds. Is the ET300 mini enough for her, or will I need an 800 for a medium large dog? And can I get this through your website store? Okay. It's not the weight of the dog that you have to go by. It's about the levels of the dog that you might have to go. Lenny is talking about a remote collar by eCollar Technology. You can go to eCollar.com. Yes, you can go through my website and order it, but you can also go through eCollar.com. The 800 is a very super powerful unit. I don't like to say that it's size-wise. So if they're advertising it as the 800 is for a medium and large, it's actually not. It's more of a more powerful unit. The size of the dog does not matter. We use the 300 on 150 to 200 pound dogs. And I use the 800 on 30 pound dogs. It all depends on what levels that you have to use to do it. Chances are the 300 is going to work. The good thing about the 800 is, if you need the extra power, you've got it. But on the 300, if you find that yourself, you're always up at the 60, 70 level, it's always good to go with an 800. But if you work with a dog and you train the way I train right from the beginning, chances are the 300 will be enough. Every once in a while, we need a 800. That's more of our stubborn dogs, as well as actually sometimes our super nervous, fearful dogs. We've got to use a stronger unit. All right, so give that a shot. Give that a shot. You'll be able to do that. All right. Great, thank you. And I want folks to put in your chat questions. I do these shows for you. The reason why, excuse me, I do these shows, I'm slightly losing my voice here. Great espresso by Clover made that one. I believe it was Clover that walked into the room. We had 7 children. If you're not familiar with me, my name is Jeff Gellman. I've got a company called Solid Canine Training, and I travel the country training dogs with my RV, rvdogtrainer.com. You can go see my seminar schedule. I've got two seminars scheduled in Canada coming up, as well as 6 more scheduled in the United States. And that just goes through the first week of January 2016. We're looking to go over to Europe. We're looking at the UK, Singapore, and Australia for starters. Joe writes, hey Joe, how are you, by the way? Jeff, I have a roughly 1-year-old German Shepherd dog. She has high prey drive. How do I get her and my small dog to coexist? I'm afraid there could be an accident, so I don't let them around each other. If at all, she's an in-your-face kind of dog. It's not aggressive. It's more playful. Okay, so you can have a dog with a high prey drive. But so high prey drive and high prey drive with the same species is not as much of a concern. So I've got dogs with high prey drive, for instance, Girl. Girl is one of my dogs, and she's got intense prey drive, but she's not attacking small dogs. So if you're talking about a dog that's got intense prey drive towards, say, cats, so we've got dogs that are cat killers. Again, a cat killer is not a dog killer. Okay, cats are food sources, and cats are considered prey in the wild. We've just happened to domesticate them, and they live with us as pets. So what you can do is, the only way you're going to be able to get it to work is you've got to get the dogs to coexist with each other. By keeping them apart, you're never going to know if they're going to work or not. So you're going to have to get them to work. All right. So what I'm going to do is I would suggest you start working on some socialization. And socialization, the way you should be running your socialization is in a calm setting and not in an excited setting. So it's really, really important. We do socialization. In fact, I just put up some photos every day from our socialization yard. Tomorrow I'll be putting up more. Today I helped run the socialization at the training center. And we always do a 1-to-5 ratio, one staff member per 5 dogs, I think. So there's 2 of us out there. We had 10 dogs, and they were all being nice and calm. I think it's some of these we do daycare minimally. We're a training center that offers daycare for our dogs. And I think when I hear about one staff member for like 25 or 30 dogs, I think that's very irresponsible to do. I think it'd be very, very, very dangerous protocol for a training center. They're not training centers, they're daycares. Carrie Girl says she went to the Gainesville seminar. It was great, learned a lot. Awesome. I'm glad you learned it. You learned a lot. That's great. Joe asks, okay, would you muzzle her at all for safety just in case? I don't know your dog. I mean, muzzles also, they put a lot of pressure on dogs. If your dog's not muzzle conditioned, it can make it worse. If your dog is at all aggressive, though, yes, then muzzle the dog. Personally, with me, I would test your dog on one of my smaller dogs. I own Chihuahuas, and then I also have big dogs, and they can coexist. But to play it safe, yes, muzzle it, because I don't want the question next week to be, hey, Jeff, my high prey drive German Shepherd dog killed my little dog. Do you recommend a mass, what are they calling it? They incinerate a dog, or a private one, cremation. Would you suggest a mass cremation or an individual cremation? Actually, individual cremation is much better. But so I don't want that to be the question. So yes, muzzle the dog if you're concerned. For aggressive dogs, Joe over at Virginia Beach asked, what muzzles do you use for your aggressive dog protocols? For aggressive dog protocols, I can get away with the Baskerville muzzles. I can get away with the Baskerville muzzles. If you're not familiar with the Baskerville muzzles, they're much more open. I use 2 kinds of muzzles. I use the Baskerville muzzle as well as the Jaffco muzzle. Jaffco muzzle is much, much, much safer for human handling, where the dogs are absolutely not going to bite you. Where a Baskerville muzzle, they actually can bite your fingers as well as they can get your clothing as well. Christina says, hi, Jeff. Just wanted to comment that I've been working with Gemma since the training this weekend. Long road ahead, but I am amazed at how effective the tools and advice you provided. I've been watching your videos, and Gemma is calm. My life is much better. That's great. Awesome. Christina, I'm proud of you. You know, this is the thing, is the information is out there. I want folks to know that Jay hey, Jeff, I'm like, Jay, you didn't miss anything. Okay. I did give out the lottery numbers, the winning lottery numbers for tonight. But other than that, you're fine. This is the thing. Well, everybody, we can start now because Jay's here. So this is the thing. Dog training is easy. It's simple. It's really simple to do. It's the concept of yes and no. That's all it is. That's all it is. So you're allowed to do this. You're not allowed to do that. Okay? You're allowed to do this. You're not allowed to do that. It's so important that people understand it. So, for instance, folks that are on my webinar now through Google Hangout won't be able to see this, but all my Meerkat fans will be able to see this. That's Uma, and that's Girl. So I just turned around my phone. So I stream Meerkat on my cell phone, and they're in place. So they're up on a dog couch. This is my office, so they're allowed on the couch. I make it easy. That's where you have to be, and you can't be anywhere else. If you get down from there, I say no, and I put you back up there. Usually I just have to say no, and they go back up. But the chances of them breaking command are slim to none. So all you have to do is you've got to make commands non-negotiable. And we had a conversation with somebody, we should see, maybe he'll tune in tonight as well, and somebody that was struggling with their dog whenever they were in the kitchen, and if it got around the kitchen table, the dog would growl at them. And which, out of all due respect, folks, it amazes me that people would allow their dogs to be by the kitchen counter. Have your dog go lay down on a mat in another room. It's really simple. Don't allow them by the kitchen counter. It's really simple. Just, you know, right before this, when I got home from work today, people that follow me, they know who Angelo is. And Angelo is my two-year-old, and he's out by the pool, you know, with six dogs. But he can only go so close to the pool. It's non-negotiable. Michelle says, yay, Gemma, good for you, Christina. That's good. Hey, Michelle, how are you? And the folks on Meerkat, thank you so much for, you know, the folks on Meerkat, if you want to help me out, you can like this, you can retweet this. And that's how I start getting a lot of followers on Meerkat. Okay? And by the way, on Meerkat this weekend, this Saturday, I'm going to be streaming the show live from the radio station. And you'll be able to see Linda, my co-host, and it's a live call-in radio show. You'll actually be able to call in as well. You can call in at 888-345-0790. That's 888-345-0790. Spencer writes, hey, Jeff, my name is Spencer. I was wondering what a good time limit to get a second dog. I have a one-year-old German Shepherd dog now that I've been training to be more of a working protection dog, but I don't want to interfere with his training to teach the newer dog anything wrong. It's up to you, Spencer. All depends on how much time you have, right? How much time you have. You absolutely can, you know, and if you don't want to teach that dog to do protection work, you absolutely can have one dog doing protection and one dog not doing protection. You can do that. You know, all your protection training, also the dog has to, if you're training it as a working dog and you're going to keep it as a kennel when you're not working it, that's one thing. But if you're going to be including it into your family, into your house, both dogs have to learn to go to a mat in place. They have to learn how to do a down. There's a lot of things they have to do. So I think it's time. I don't see why not. I mean, right now, if I was offered, I've got nine dogs right now. If I was offered another dog, a good dog, I did pass on a Belgian Malinois. I encourage every single person out there that not to get a Belgian Malinois if you are just a family, unless you're going to work that dog and not fantasy work it. Like, you know, not like, oh, you sit your ass down on a couch and you want to get your dog into, you know, protection work and IPO and you've got all these fantasies. And meanwhile, you know, well, I want to train my dog to be a search and rescue dog. And like, you don't walk in the rain or the snow, or you can't walk more than half a mile, trust me, don't get yourself a search and rescue dog if you can't walk more than half a mile. Because when you actually do search and rescue, you actually walk places like the woods through the rain at night with bugs and snakes, bears. Like, so if you're not an outdoor person, don't become a search and rescue person. So you got to be really, really careful about getting a Malinois. I actually passed on a Malinois. It's funny because I was offered I was offered a Malinois about a month, 6 weeks ago from a very, John actually knows who the breeder is. And I was like, I'm not ready for a Malinois. And it's funny because I asked him, I said, well, you know, why don't you keep a Malinois? And he goes to me, I'm not ready to raise another Malinois puppy. And this is a Malinois breeder. I mean, he's smart enough to know, you know, he could have kept one of his own dogs, but he's smart enough to know how much work it takes to raise a puppy, let alone a male puppy. So, you know, he passed on that as well. Let me get back to my question. So Spencer, to answer your question, I think you're ready to do it now. Okay. Joe says, Jeff, when I put Maggie in place on her mat, how do I get her to not leave the bat if I leave the room? It's like she's a kid with ADHD. Her attention span is horrible. Joe, of course, because you just start training. Okay. Number one, you can put her on a tie out and a tie back station or a tie out station. A tie back station, you can put her in a tie back station, which isn't training, but it keeps her from moving off of place. If you're going to do a tie back station, what I want you to do is I want you to give the dog enough room that it can break place, but at least it can't run to you. But you know, to keep a dog in command, the magic of keeping a dog in command is, number one, you've got to get the dog out of kindergarten, and you've got to start going towards your high school diploma. And in order to get the dog out of kindergarten, there has to be a series of consequences. And during the learning phase, we don't do a consequence for the dog. I think it's pretty mean to give a dog a high-level consequence when they're still learning something. But once they've learned place, so if your dog, Joe, can go to place, you say, place, the dog goes to place, lays down. It knows place. Okay, great. Prong collar on, leash on, place, walk towards the exit, turn around, walk back, walk outside the room, walk back, walk outside the room for longer, walk back. If that dog breaks place, it's three parts. Three parts. Mark it with no. It's funny, Carol looks at me when I say no. Mark it with no. Walk over calmly. Pick up the leash. Correction. Bring the dog back. Eventually, with the word no, the dog goes back. Eventually, with a correction, the dog goes back on its own. But until there's a consequence for leaving place, the dog will never hold. It'll never hold. So that's the magic for duration work. That's the magic for getting a dog to work at a higher level with high levels of distraction. The reward of praise or food is not enough of a reward historically to keep a dog in place when there's a higher level of distraction. Okay. All right, Joe. Let's erase that. Janet, how long do you suggest use of the e-collar? Is this something you eventually wean off of, or something you work them for life? That's up to you, Janet. That's up to you. My dogs are naked. My dogs are all naked. They don't wear any collar whatsoever. Every once in a while, I'll put a little slip lead on them if I've got to go into a mandatory leash law place. I just went 5 weeks with my dogs on an RV trip. I think they had a leash on two or three times. When I took Girl on a 10,000 mile RV trip, she had a leash on once when we were in St. Augustine, Florida. That's it. But I think That's up to you. I encourage people to, whenever you're outside, to always have your remote collar on. When you're in an off-leash area, when you're outside, you know, the one time your dog decides not to listen and to chase something, and your remote collar is in your car or at home, what good is your remote collar? I wear my seatbelt every single time. If I'm in a parking lot, if I'm in a shopping center parking lot in front of Staples, and if I have to go to Home Depot, which is what, a couple hundred yards away, I could walk, but usually it's Home Depot. I got to pick up supplies. I put my seatbelt on. I don't put my car in drive unless my seatbelt is on. I wear it all the time. I'm a safe driver. I've only been in a couple accidents in my life, none of them life-threatening, you know, but I always wear it. So a remote collar is not a failure. You know, a lot of dog trainers out there will try to make it look like, oh, if you have to use a training tool, your dog is not trained. Well, fine. Then my dog sucks. Okay, but chances are the person that made that statement, my dog and most of my clients' dogs are probably better trained than theirs. And we're not talking about in a show ring. We're talking about out in public. So it's not a failure. It's not a failure. Let's see. Sammy, Jeff, I cannot find the Herm. Herm does not make the 175 millimeter prong collar. If they're made in somewhere in Asia, go to Pawmark, Pawmark, Pawmark.com. You can find them there. Joe says she knows place. We use a combination of prong and e-collar work. We also use no. I use the prong more, so the e-collar is only used for high stress situations. You can also use the, you know, Joe, if the dog's already trained on a remote collar, I would do the remote collar then. So if you got a dog that's trained on the remote collar, your dog breaks place, no, continuous button, hold the button down. Hold the button down till the dog goes back. If the dog knows what it means, if you hold the button down on the continuous level and the dog starts running around, going from place to place, running over to you, it doesn't know. That's why a tie back might be better for that. Okay. Christina. Hey, Christina. Hey, everybody on Meerkat. How you doing? Oh, great. Great. Thank you. People are liking it and retweeting it. Thank you so much, guys, on Meerkat. Best thing you can do is like this show, retweet this show. And join up. I'm a brand new person on Meerkat, and I'm really, I love offering the stream. And every Monday and Wednesday, I'm on from 9 to 11, I'm sorry, from 9 to 10 p.m. And then on Saturday mornings, I've got a live radio show. I'm on Saturday mornings. So, everybody on Meerkat, how you doing? Christina says, Jeff, is it okay during training to leave the prong collar on in the house when I'm here? Absolutely. Obviously, I use it for walking and training in the house. Absolutely. Okay. Sammy says, please do not get mad. I'm getting cold feet about using it. I'm reading horror stories, and I'm not sure who or what to believe. Do dog gets hurt using them? Okay, well, so Sammy, I've trained over 3,000 dogs. I've used a prong collar on, I believe, all but one. I've never seen a dog hurt on a prong collar. I have never seen a dog hurt. Sammy, I'm talking to you. I want you to know I have never seen a dog hurt on a prong collar, ever. So what you read about them is an outright lie. It is misinformation. It is a lie. It is a lie. It is powerful. The people that don't believe in balance training are just as fanatical and powerful as a cult. I've got videos. People are fully training their dogs to off-leash capacity by watching my videos using the tools, techniques, and philosophies that I preach. I'm a real dog trainer with a working kennel, getting real results, practicing what I preach. You ask me a question, you will get an instant answer. If you go to one of my RV dog training seminars, I have no idea what the problems are with dogs. You bring me your dog, I work on it on the spot, right there, immediately. I can't tell you, I'll get back to you. I can't look it up in a book. I can't call a colleague. I fix the problem right in front of you. I'm letting you know, as a very professional dog trainer, you will not hurt your dog on a prong collar as long as you train the way I train. Okay. Robin in Australia. Hey, Robin. Hey, Robin. I want to do a seminar in Australia. Okay. 2016. I want to be in Australia. I think I'm hearing Brisbane is a good spot to do one. Help me out. All right. Help me out. Okay. Let me go through some of these here. John says it does not hurt. Let's go through some of these. Janet, I answered your question already. Joe answered your question. It's like a stock market stream. Okay. Michelle says, exactly. I discovered this today with Chance, and trust me, I want to give a high-level correction. He gets my blood boiling. Well, Michelle, you want to learn how to control that. No dog should get your blood boiling. Okay? Okay. I decided to continue and train myself. I'm working on timing with commands and tone. For the novice, training can be a scary undertaking. Absolutely. Doing anything can be scary, right? Anything can be scary. Meerkat, Scorchnack 2014, the real horror stories are when you watch a disobedient dog get hit by a car. Great point. Excellent point. Every year, 100,000 dogs are killed by cars. 100,000 of them. I can't tell you how many people, their dogs run outside. You tell them to come back, they don't come back. I can't tell you. How many people have a dog in the backyard, their own backyard? I can't imagine this. You've got a dog in your own backyard. It doesn't come to you when you call it. You've got to be kidding me. Train your dog. Train your dog. I mean, that's why I've got a business. I'm not going to complain that loud. But then again, I give away all my training. I give away all my training. Spencer goes, when will your next seminar in Virginia Beach be? Well, there won't be a next seminar in Virginia Beach because there hasn't been a first seminar in Virginia Beach. But I don't know. I don't know. I think I've got 2015 already booked solid. I think I've got it booked solid. I've got one weekend, I think, in August available that I can possibly pull off a seminar. I don't know. I don't know. It'd be great. It'd be great. I possibly would do one in the way down to Florida. I can't do one on the way down to Florida. That's booked already. I'm going to be down in the Florida area. I'm going to be down there for January and February. So I'm going to be looking for a business down in Florida for January and February. In January, second weekend of January, I'm doing a seminar in Ellington, Florida, which is south of Tampa, north of Bradenton. So John actually says we're going to have one. I'm going to sponsor it. All right, John, we should get together and talk. We should get together and talk. Yeah, Spencer and John. Spencer, you and John get together and talk. We'll talk. I mean, what you got to do is you got to get the information to my assistant. My assistant's name is Lauren. Just email her, Lauren, L-A-U-R-E-N. Lauren at Solid Canine Training. She's my personal assistant, and she handles all the bookings. Joe says, will you guys be coming to San Antonio or nearby at all next year? I'm very interested in T3 launch. T3 launch, the next T3 is not in Texas. We were just in Dallas. The next T3 is in Providence. After that, it's in California and then Portland. I would suggest you should come to the T3 in Providence, San Antonio to Providence. Keep in mind that T3, it's a 6-day seminar, Joe, and people from around the world come to it. So you have to jump on a plane for that. As far as the RV seminar, which is different, it's going to be, I'll be in Austin, and Dallas in November. Austin, Dallas, it's not confirmed, but I think it's the 12th and 13th of December. And Austin is, I believe, 2 weekends prior to Thanksgiving week. I don't have the dates. I don't have the dates handy. All right. But it'd be worth it for you to come up to there. Lenise says, okay, thanks. I answered one of her questions first. I've been working on focus training with food today. After several times today, she's better, but she only takes the food maybe 10 times and becomes uninterested. I start over to regain her focus, but then she'll quit sitting. Is this where the remote should come in? No, that's where she's eating, she's full, comes in. So she's done. She's done. So your food drive is gone. So your food drive is gone. So cut back on the food. Only use food for training. So what you can do is, you can do focus work with one of your meals, and then obedience work with another one of your meals. Does that make sense? So use one of the meals, do active active work, all your basic commands, or you can also turn some of your basic commands into focus. So you can do, when you're doing come, sit, break, call the dog to you, have the dog sit, focus, break. You can do down, focus, break. You can do a lot of, you can do things like that if you want to. Sammy says, how do you decide where to go? That's a good question, Sammy. I go where people want me to go. I go, for instance, here's a good example. I go, so I'm driving in November, I'm gonna be going for a 4-week RV trip. And so I'm driving to California. My folks live in California. We spend Thanksgiving with them. So I'm driving out there. So I'm heading from Providence, Rhode Island, west. So I would go, and I only have 2 weeks, I've got 2 weeks to get to San Diego, and then I got 2 weeks to get back. So I can only do 2 seminars each way. So the first one I'm doing is in Austin, and then I'm doing one in Tucson. These are people that own training centers, and these are people who I've done seminars with before. Or it's somebody I know. It's one of my students in T3. T3 is train the trainers. So I do them in places with people that I know or people that have hosted seminars. So you need people that understand how a seminar works. Sometimes we've talked to people that own a training center, and they're like, oh, I would never have a seminar. Why would I want Jeff to come to my place to do a seminar? He's going to take away all my business. That's what you call an ignorant business owner that doesn't see the big picture. It's like, I'll tell you why you want to do a seminar. Because people are going to drive from all over to come to your location. They're going to learn about you. They don't even know about you yet. I'm giving you tons of free advertising and promotion, and you're probably going to pick up some board and trains, some one-on-one clients, and they're going to refer friends to you. So by you hosting me there for the weekend, if you were smart, you can turn it into $100,000 worth of business. That's why. So that's how I do it, Sammy. John says, Spencer's in my club. Oh, okay, cool. Brooke, hi, Jeff. I'm struggling with my dog who has separation anxiety. Oh, shoot. I'm going to have to get to that question. Hold on. Let me see if I can get to it. Yep, there it is. Brooke says, hi, Jeff. I'm struggling with my dog who has separation anxiety. I've watched your video multiple times. I'm currently working on all the commands. Now what I'm having trouble with is how much daily structure to implement and what that would look like. Oh, that's a great question, Brooke. Well, just to let you know, I just put up a video of kennel life, which is a short on my Facebook page. If folks are not on my Facebook page, Meerkat, if you're not on my Facebook page, what I want you to do is, I do everything through social media, everything. So I've got a website, obviously, solidcanintraining.com, but this is how intense my Facebook page is. When my wife wants to know where I am, she looks on my Facebook page. That's how she knows where I am. What I do is I put up a video of just, you know, dogs quiet in a kennel. Even in the kennel, the dog should be quiet. So you can spend an hour a day doing obedience work, and then you can do 2 structured walks. You can do some outdoor play, some tug work, some fetch, If you want to take a walk in the woods, if you want to go to the beach, that's great. But I still, you need to do the structure work. And then other than that, your dog can just be hanging out. Can be hanging out. Separation anxiety. Here's an interesting concept with separation anxiety. You ready? I own 9 dogs. I only raised one of them. Okay? I only raised one of them. None of them have separation anxiety. I don't think I got lucky. We've got a kennel. We've got 15 to 20 dogs in there at a time. Half of them come in on their worksheets, separation anxiety. After 24 hours, none of them are exhibiting signs of separation anxiety. Think about that. We just met the dogs 24 hours prior. Separation anxiety is a man-woman made reinforced thing. Now, yes, I'm sure there are some dogs that have got medical separation anxiety where they destroy the house. But guess what? Why is your dog out of the crate? Well, my dog breaks out of the crate. Don't let your dog break out of the crate. You actually can make your dog not break out of crates. What do? You use a pretty high aversive when the dog starts to break out of the crate. And that's not mean. It's the kindest thing you can do. A dog that breaks out of a crate destroys its teeth, destroys its house. It could die. I have clients whose dogs have jumped out of second floor windows to chase their owner's car down the street. I have clients who bite holes through walls, through sheetrock to get out of rooms. All that could be stopped with electronics. All of it. All of it. And if somebody's sitting out there saying, oh, so you shock a dog when it's already afraid? Number one, we're not shocking the dog. Number two, you absolutely can use fear to fight fear. Absolutely. 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 Show of hands. Who doesn't walk in front of a bus? I don't. Why not? I'm afraid of dying. That's why. You can use fear to fight fear. All right? So I want you to follow everything I do 100%. Okay? All right. Joe says, Jeff, how do you work on start focused healing? I recently started Maggie and IPO. I don't know. I don't do any IPO stuff. I don't do any competition obedience. I don't do any focused healing. There's a couple of guys on this board here, John and Spencer. But guess what? This ain't their show. So actually now with my new technology, I can actually put John's camera on so you guys can see it. What I would do is I would go online and I would Google focused healing, and you can probably do it. You're going to do it with food, or you're going to do it with a ball. So if you've got a dog with high ball drive or high food drive, you're going to use those tools to get focused healing. You're most likely going to use food. You're most likely going to use food to do it. Hold on here. Let me just, I gotta delete some of these questions I've already talked about. Hold on, folks. Nina, question from Vancouver, Canada. Hey, Nina, I've got 2 seminars coming up in Canada, by the way. I work at a shelter and just adopted an 8-month-old dog. Got basic commands down and just got a mini educator. I'm having a hard time finding the working level. Got up to 20 gradually and still didn't see any response. Cow was very snug. Could it be loose puppy skin? Okay. So, Nina, what I want you to do is I want to make sure that cow is on super snug here or here. Okay? And if it's got thick fur, you might have to use the longer prongs. And I want you to use the continuous button, and I want you to double tap. And I want you to look at the neck really closely. And if you see that neck, the neck muscles moving, you got a working level, right? I also want you to do it in a very quiet area. And I do not want you to do it on the grass. I want you to do it on pavement that's quiet, or inside that's quiet with no other distractions. Radio off, TV off, no kids running around. I want that dog to be in a sitting position, not lying down, or standing position. And I want you to be really focused on that dog. And I want you to click, click, 11, 12, 13, 20. It could be higher. Keep going up to past 20 to see what the level looks like. Also, make sure the collar is actually on. I know that sounds simple. I myself have gone like up to 20 before, and I'm like, let me check the fit. And I realized I didn't put the collar, I didn't put the receiver on. So even I have made that mistake, and I've remote collar trained a ton of dogs. If you see the muscles moving, you know the dog is feeling it, start working. A lot of our bully breeds, they don't like to show any movement at all, and they will not show that they feel it, all right? And I'm gonna be over, I've got two, go to rvdogtrainer.com. I'm gonna be up in Canada twice this year. Taya says, how do you feel about putting two dogs in one kennel? I'm not a big fan of it, but I've done it before. One of my dogs recently died, Max. He's my oldest shepherd. At night, I had two of my dogs in one kennel. They just slept in it, no big deal. I didn't have a problem with it. George, hey George, hey everybody, I'm Meerkat. Hold on, let me see you here. Margie says, your dog, hey Sophie, your dog Sophie says hi, she likes watching you. Margie, no she doesn't, but thank you anyway. How are you? It's good to see you too, thank you. George says, Jeff, I've been doing structured walk. Well, Margie, I shouldn't say that. When I do my clients who I've worked with, whenever they have my show on, the dog immediately comes over to them and lies down next to them and does not move for the whole show because they hear my voice. So there's a cool concept on that. Uh-oh, hold on. Sorry, guys. Are you going to bet? Okay, come here.
I'm sure.
You gonna go to bed? You wanna say hello? You wanna say hi? That's Meerkat. Say hi, Meerkat. And this is everybody on Google. Say hey, everybody on Google. Say hi, Google.
No.
No? Are you going to bed?
Yeah.
Yeah, are your friends in bed?
Me, good night, Coco, Mommy.
Yeah? You gonna say goodnight to them first?
Yeah.
And give your sisters a big hug?
Yeah.
Okay, like, can I have a kiss? Have a hug? Okay, I love you. You help me with the puppies tomorrow? You gonna go swimming?
Yeah.
Wanna go swimming with all the puppies?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll see you later.
Brush my teeth and mama.
Okay, bye bye.
Me brush my teeth.
Sorry about that. All right. Okay, hold on here. George, we start with George. Jeff, I've been doing structured walks on the prong collar with my shepherd about a half hour. Then we go to the flat collar and flexi leash for a walk in the woods. And then I swim. Am I confusing my dog by doing this? George, that's a really good question. That's a really good question. Why don't you do some remote collar training, George? Do some remote collar training. Why don't you do remote collar training? I don't have a problem with that, George. I'm not a big fan of flexi leads at all. I'm not a big fan of flexi leads, but you know, when you're walking in the woods, you're right. You really don't want to have your dog in a heel. You want to have your dog a little bit more casual. And you definitely don't want a flexi on a prong. I'd love to see you just switch over. I would love to see you do remote collar training because then the remote collars are waterproof. I'd love to see you do that. Why don't you do some remote collar training? I got some good videos on that. But no, I don't think you're confusing your dog if you release your dog. If you really leash, if you just do like a let's go instead of heel. So just like let's go, a little bit more casual, you can do that. But I would take advantage of the woods. See, the great thing about remote collar heeling is you can have your dog on the remote collar, dragging a 25-foot long line or a 15-foot long line, and when it's walking in the woods, you can practice all your recalls. You can practice all your recall training. So I'd look into that. But I don't think you're confusing your dog. As long as you give your dog a command. Okay? Janet says, hi, Jeff. I've just introduced a pool to my facility. Awesome. Any tips or advice on working dogs in the pool? I'd love to get the newbies calmer in a more timely fashion and end the session with a calm, confident dog that looks forward to the next swim lesson. Sure. First of all, Janet, I've got two videos out on my YouTube channel on how to train a dog on an in-ground pool and how to train a dog on an above-ground pool. So at my house, I've got a wonderful in-ground pool. At work, I've got an above-ground pool. And I want you to know, every single dog I train the exact same way. Every dog I train the same way. Every dog. And I show it in the video. But as far as getting them calm, remember, you don't have to, I'm gonna take a little, oh my God, it's melting. My kids brought me this little snack. Oops, it's melting, I gotta eat it. They brought me this snack. This is so rude, oh my gosh. This is so impolite. Oh shoot. Sorry guys. How gross is this, watching them? That was so gross. I'm so sorry, everybody. That was so unacceptable. That was so unacceptable. I'm so sorry. Obviously, it didn't stop me. Okay, where am I here? Michelle, I have bully breeds. How will I know they're working level at home if they don't like to show it? They all show it. Michelle, they all show it. Okay. But if this is the Michelle whose dogs are at my place, we'll tell you what the working levels are. Sean asks, where did you get your kennels? Those kennels I got are from Options Plus. They're from Options Plus, and last I heard, they were out of business. For about 6 months prior, I knew they were going out of business because their customer service and their delivery was horrendous. So I knew they were going out of business, and then they went out of business. I think they're from Ohio. I'm not sure if anybody bought them, but the kennel panels themselves are the kennel panels themselves are from Options Plus. John says, for the person who asked about focused healing, Michael Fraz with Precision Dog. There we go. Look up Precision Dog Sport. Precision Dog Sport on YouTube. Thank you, John, for reminding me on that. Sammy says, could you do a video on how you produce the show? I'm an IT geek and would like to hear about that. Sammy, this is not the what would Jeff do to produce a show. This is the what would Jeff do dog training show. Sammy, I'm using something called Webinar Jam. I'm doing Webinar Jam, and that's all I'm doing is Webinar Jam. I've added Meerkat to it, which is a separate camera, and I'm using the camera I'm using is a conference call camera. It's a special conference call camera, but there's no reason why you can't use your, I'm on a laptop, the laptop camera, and I'm using also a mic, but there's no reason why you can't just use your basic mic. So I'm just doing this, like I'm literally doing this, you know, very inexpensive and basic. I would love to be able to do all kinds of fancier stuff. Like right now I can play a video, I can be streaming guests on this, I can be running the bottom third of the screen, I can be running, you know, all kinds of different things around this, but I'm not. So that's how I do it. All right. Let me go through this. Let's see. Spencer, is there a problem with having your dog in a kennel during the day but not at night? Oh, hold on here. I'm losing questions here. Hold on. I got a lot of questions. Let me go to the right from the bottom. Let's see. Nina says, P.S. So thankful for all your advice and information. We're not allowed to use corrections or prong e-collars, but I've been able to use many of your techniques to help the dogs. I wish I could not do more for them, but I do what I'm allowed, able, looking for as many tools under my belt. Okay, Nina, I'm not quite sure why you can't use a correction, because everything's a correction in life. If you put a leash on a dog, you're correcting it. If you say no to a dog, you're correcting it. If you're walking a dog on a flat buckle collar, you come to a stop, you're correcting the dog. When you close the door of your car. If you put a dog in your car and you close the doors, you're correcting your dog. So we live in a world of aversives. We live in a world of aversives. Nina says, another dumb question, no such thing, especially if you don't know the answer. When training a dog to go potty on command, do you have a different command for pee or poo? Nope, I just say go potty. I just say go potty and I hope for the best. So it's not a dumb question. Let's see. I'm gonna get to everybody's question, don't worry. I'll get to every single person's question. A lot of questions today, thank you. A lot of people on Meerkat as well. Thanks, Meerkat. Good job, guys. Thank you. I appreciate it. Let's see, Spencer, is there a problem with having your dog in a kennel during the day but not at night? We put him in the crate when we go to work because he chews on things, but at night he sleeps in the room with us and doesn't bother anything. That's not my number one preference, but if you're doing that, if you're not having problems, keep doing it. If it works for you, keep doing it. All right? Brooke says, okay, thanks. Do you think that part of his structure would be the dog being able to freely walk but under supervision around a room or a floor of a house? Or should they always be in command or crated? This is the thing. I don't allow free roaming. To me personally, I don't understand what the benefit of free roaming is. If I'm going to spend time with my dogs, why don't I have them in command? It lowers their stress. It lowers the stress. Most of us have a hard enough time spending time with our dogs. We don't have time to spend time with our dogs. Why don't we have them, if we're sitting down and our dogs are in the room, why don't we have the dogs in command? But if you want to do free roaming, do free roaming. If it works for you, works for you. All right, works for you. All right. Let's see. Margie says, not rude, just fine, sweet. The kids do. Yeah, the kids bring me up. The kids bring me food and coffee. And then don't forget. Oh, thank you. Hey, everybody, I'm Meerkat. If you could do me a favor and retweet this show and like the show, favorite the show, I'd really appreciate it. I've been on the radio. I've been doing podcasts for over a year. I've been on the radio for over, this is my 6th year of doing radio shows. And it'd be great to just get a new audience with Meerkat. There's so many people out there struggling with their dogs. 4 million dogs a year being killed. I'm a real world dog trainer. And you can check me out on Facebook, Solid Canine Training on Facebook. And you can see what I do every day. I put up videos and photos. And I'm really passionate about the work that I do. So if you folks would like me and retweet me, that'd be really, really great. I'd appreciate it. John says, I like your ramp on your pool. My dogs seem to have problems with the pool stairs. Yeah, we just built that ramp, just pretty much a piece of plywood. Serbin, who's my handyman, he built it. The dogs seem to like it at home. I've got a beach entrance, so the water, the pool starts at like 6 inches and goes down. Okay. Brian says, hi, Jeff. Bruno and I are working on healing, using their dominant collar, but I have a force of habit of popping the collar. I know. Is it okay? Should I use the dominant collar strictly for harsh corrections? Brian, I want you to master the remote collar heel. I want you to only use that dominant dog collar if he comes up the leash at you. But I want you to use I know it's going to be a hard habit for you to break. I want you to use the remote collar to heal the dog. Practice it. So every time you want to pop the leash, hit the button instead. All right? Hit the button instead. I want you to know I'm proud of you. I'm really proud of you. Sammy, I read on your Facebook page that you had like 8 dogs, but only take a few of them. Why not take all of them? And is the guard dog only a guard dog and not a pet? Great question, Sammy. So I only take dogs to work with me that can help me with my work. So I've got 2 Chihuahuas. They don't help me with my work. Those are sort of my wife's dogs. Then I've got an older pit bull who likes to just hang out in the sun. And then I've got a feral dog who she's not trained. I trained her to do one thing, and that was to come back on command. Her primal instinct is to run away for things, and all she does is come back on command now, and she runs with my pack. And then I've got another dog Ronan, who's a Turkish Kangal, he lives at the center. He does nighttime patrol. My guard dog, Mac, yes, that's all he does is guard. He's also safe around my kids, though. You'll see him. He actually was in the, there's a picture of him with two other shepherds the other day in the back of my SUV. And we had a vet coming to work to give some dogs some shots, and he's been limping on one of his legs. So I wanted to take advantage of that and just bring Mac with me. But Mac stays at my house. He works 24/7 on my property. But he's also a safe family dog. He's safe with my kids, and he's safe with all immediate family members. Other than that, you don't want to come on my property. Okay. Let's see. I'm going to get Sean and Amy. You mentioned you have 9 dogs. What breeds are they? I just went down through those. Okay. Ryan, thanks, Jeff. You're welcome, Ryan. Michelle, yes, it's me. They're being worked a lot during the day at your facility. How long do you suggest an average person work their dog daily? You know, if you did an hour of obedience and then an hour of walks and then you did some outdoor time, that's enough for most dogs. That's enough for most dogs. Rhonda says, I just purchased a Boss, kind of afraid to use it, but I have to learn to use it to teach this nervous, afraid lab that I have. Where should I get started? Grandchildren will be here in a week. I'm so nervous. All right, well, Rhonda, don't expect to have that dog trained in a week. So you sort of waited to the last minute. So what I want you to do is I want you to keep the dog separate from the grandkids. I know the grandkids, if I recall from your previous webinars, are going to be there for 3 weeks. You want to be really super cautious. Keep that dog on a leash. You can always put that dog in a crate. You know, the first thing you should be doing is come, sit, break, and place. Come, sit, break, and place. What I don't want you to do, Rhonda, what I absolutely do not want you to do is push that button to correct that dog when it's done something wrong, because that dog should not be on correction level after a week. So I don't want you to do that. I absolutely do not want you doing that, all right? I don't like people that get the remote and just use it for no. Hold on, this is throat spray. This is from one of my wife's friend's companies, Fellow Workers Farm, propolis, honey, Marinara, and sage. Good for my throat. Apple cider vinegar and water. It's supposed to lower my cholesterol. All right. So, Rhonda, you shouldn't have been waiting. Come on now. Let's get with the program, Rhonda. Let's get with the program. Okay? Nikki, can you explain more about using fear to deal with fear, please? Absolutely. Absolutely, Nikki. This is the thing. We deal with a ton of fearful dogs, a lot of fearful dogs. Everybody thinks they see a fearful dog and love, hugs, kisses, freedom, petting, praise is going to help them. It absolutely does not. Structure, guidance, rules, boundaries, obedience, and consequences rehabilitate a fearful dog. Okay? Remember, this is somebody that successfully rehabilitates fearful dogs on a daily basis. Here's a good example. I've got a dog that it's afraid. It's a fear biter. It's a fear biter. Okay? So, we do a combination of yes and no training with all our dogs. We do yes and no training. Yes, I want you to do all these commands, all these behaviors. Okay? All these behaviors. But no is, I don't want you to do that behavior. And the no is through a correction, usually a remote collar correction, such as biting, all right? But I've got a good example of a dog. Say there's a dog that does not want to come back to me because it's afraid of me. Okay? We can instill fear in the dog. We can use fear. Of course, we want it to come back to us for good stuff. But how about this? I can make it more fearful and uncomfortable for you to be away from me than close to me. So if I've got a dog on a long line, 25-foot line, and it's so nervous and stressed that it won't come to me. Okay? And these are not dogs, you know, everybody thinks these dogs have been abused. Just to let you know, I'm not discounting abuse. A lot of dogs probably are abused, but I think it's out of proportion, the lies that go on there about abuse. It's a story that rescues tell you, so you'll adopt the dog, feel bad for it, baby it, and then you end up with a mess dog. So if a dog, say, is always trying to get away from you because it's afraid, and I'm sorry, I don't care how many juicy hot dogs and how many kind praises and how much love and affection you give that dog, it doesn't matter. It's still going to be afraid to be with you. This whole concept of if you give enough dog enough love and affection, it'll be behaved, that's an outright lie. That's an outright lie. It doesn't work that way. It's a myth. If it worked, why am I book solid? Why am I so book solid, and why are so many people struggling with dogs? Do you think people need professional help to learn how to love, hug, and kiss their dogs? No, this isn't directed at you either. It's just a general statement. Of course not. Hey, Jeff, I've got this really aggressive dog. Can you show me how to give it the proper amount of love and material rewards such as food and nice bedding? And what kind of praise should I give it so it doesn't become so aggressive? Won't work. So what you can do is, if you want to be away from me, okay, what you want to be, what you're doing is, I can make it more uncomfortable for you to be running away from me than next to me. So now I become the most comfortable part of your day by being next to me. Because most fearful dogs bite and they run away. So we can use fear. We can use fear all the time. A lot of times dogs, out of fear, will rush at people. They'll rush at people because they're afraid. So they'll break command and rush, and they'll bark. Bark, 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 bark. Really? Real. I'll tell you what. If you do that again, I'm going to give you a hard correction with a remote collar. So at the beginning stages of training on dangerous behaviors, I have no problem using fear. Absolutely no problem using fear. That's not the way, trust me, I don't want the dog to live in a state of fear. That's not what I'm saying. I don't want to rule the dog with an iron fist and it's always afraid of me that I'll come down and pound it with a correction. That's not what I'm saying. Because 90% of my training is really positive, awesome, proactive stuff. 10% of it, I got to let you know I don't agree with that. Okay? I got to let you know that I don't agree with it. And that's fair in my world. That's fair in my world. Okay? Let's see. Sammy, yep, you found it. That's probably the link. Yep, that's probably the link. I can't click on that link right now. So, Nikki, I don't know if I explained that in the way you wanted to hear it or the best way to understand it, but that's the first thing that came to mind. Okay? Rhonda says love equals discipline. Exactly. Nikki said, trainers have told me, okay, here we go. This could be good. Trainers have told me not to hard correct fear-based dog reactivity, as a dog will associate the correction with the other dog and make it worse. You're saying the exact opposite, correct? Correct. What I'm saying, what you were told, is an outright lie. Let me get a little bit simpler. It's an outright lie. It's an outright lie. If you properly condition a dog to a remote collar, And if you have an association with that dog, a working association with that dog, and you give that dog a hard correction, oh, that dog knows where it came from. It knows it came from you. And it should know that it came from you. This whole thing. Now, would I put a remote collar on a dog, let it into a dog park, it gets into a fight, and correct it? Absolutely not. I would never do that, ever. Number one, I wouldn't bring my dog to a dog park. Number two, I wouldn't use a high correction like that on a dog that I've not worked with on a remote on low levels. I wouldn't. So, but yes, dogs are smart. That's a lie. Brooke said, thanks, Jeff. I'll try it out and see what works. I was just wondering about too much downtime with the commands, if he's also going to be crated during the day when no one's around. I do. You know, I'm a big advocate of crating a dog when there's nobody around. A dog could die. A dog could die. A dog. Right now on my desk, half the stuff on my desk could kill a dog. Half of it. Easily. And the other half of the stuff would cost me a lot of money if the dog destroyed it. So, I mean, dogs are eating cell phones, remote controls, eyeglasses. Could you imagine that? Could you imagine? That's not a world that I live in. I can't imagine a dog eating a pair of my glasses. I can't imagine a dog eating my cell phone. I can't imagine a dog chewing through an electrical cord in my life. I can't imagine how that would happen. Linny says, Queenie is in an extra, extra large kennel with the holes in the sides and the back. We had a cage type kennel like the one you have, but we're told it doesn't make the dog feel as safe as the cage type. Queenie touches the top of the kennel now and getting bigger. I feel she would be more comfortable with your thoughts. You know, we've got, I mean, I think a crate is as comfortable as you make the dog feel in the crate. You know, from what I understand, airline crates, the plastic crates, dogs feel really comfortable in. We don't use them. They're not practical for our situation. We've got kennels in my house. I've got commercial grade kennels in my house for my dogs. Some of my colleagues that have got board and train facilities, they use the airline crates. I think if the dog's state of mind is in the right spot, I think the dog could be comfortable anywhere. Anywhere. I owned an Akita. It slept outside, a long-haired Akita. Slept outside in the winter. It would wake up. I couldn't even see it. I'd call the dog's name. All of a sudden, a bunch of snow moved, and out popped the dog. Would I be doing that? Nope. He did it. And he had a place to live inside. He liked it. He liked it. But if you've got a dog that when they stand up, they're touching it, good. Don't stand up. You shouldn't be standing up. You should be lying down in a crate. Brian, hi, Jeff. When a dog rushes and barks at someone out of fear, what level of correction is that on the e-collar? Double the working level or act of God? Not act of God. You can do a double. Keep it on a line, though. Keep it on a leash to make sure the dog doesn't rush forward and increase it. So, you know, dog rushing somebody should be on a leash. Correct it. You can do double your working level. Give it a shot. Okay. Nina says, at the past few years of our Pet Lover Expo in Vancouver, there have been a banned e-collar booth, gaining signatures, et cetera, sharing lots of propaganda and false information. Do you think a group like that could actually get e-collars banned here? Do you think there's anything I can do to help? Yeah, absolutely. I think Canada, I think Canada, in Canada, you guys ban handguns. So yes, I think remote collars can be banned. Absolutely. I think they can be banned in the UK. I think they're already banned in large parts of the world. What could be done about it? What could be done about it is more dog trainers and dog owners making awesome videos of dogs how great e-cowers are. I'm making it easy for folks. You know, I've been yelling and screaming from the rooftops about remote cowers and prong cowers since I've been on the radio for 6 years. Before nobody put, I know e-cower trainers that are 100% e-cower, 100% e-cower. They don't even put on their websites that they use e-cowers. What are you, spineless? Freaking put that you use e-cowers. What's the big deal? There's people that wear prong collars and they cover them up with bandanas because they're worried about public opinion. F public opinion. Show people what you're using. Show people what you're doing. I don't care. I have one obligation. I've got an obligation, you know, to the dog. Are the 4 million dogs that we're killing in the United States? Ask them. Hey, you want to stay alive? I got to put a prong collar on you, though. What do you think the dog's going to say? Hey, you know what? That gas chamber was fun. I'll take that any day. Give me a break. So what do you do about it? Train your dog. Use the tool. Shout from the rooftops. Be loud and proud. You just don't argue. So the worst thing to do is to go into that booth and, like, yell and scream at them. You can't reason with an idiot. You can't reason with an idiot. If people come up to me, that's why I don't respond to hate mail. I just ban and delete you. I'm no fun to hate. I've become no fun to hate anymore because I won't argue with you. When I first started doing this, I used to argue with people about all this stuff. Now I just ban and delete you. Could you imagine that? Think about this concept. Somebody goes on to my Facebook page and they write something nasty. I ban and I delete them. You know what that means? Tomorrow, when they look for my Facebook page, they can't find it anymore. What kind of power that is that I have? You know what kind of power that is? I don't exist anymore to them. That blows their mind. You know how frustrating it is now? They can't hate me anymore because they can't find me. So it doesn't bother me. Spencer says we have a metal crate that when the dog stands up, his back is on the top, but he lays down just fine and sleeps all day. Yeah, absolutely. Dogs should be sleeping in crates. They should be sleeping in crates. Lenny says when she barks at my boys when they come in, we tell her quiet from her previous training. She's just not listening, so what is the correction while she's in the kennel? Use a remote collar. Remote collar. Quiet. Remote. Quiet. Remote. That's all. So quiet has a meaning. All right, guys. 10:13. Any last questions? Any last comments? I'll be on the radio this Saturday on AM 790 in the Rhode Island Market. You can find the link to my radio show. I'll put it up on Facebook. You can find the link. You'll be able to watch it. It's live in a studio. This is in my home. The radio show is actually in a radio studio with my co-host Linda and Meerkat. I'm going to have you guys there too. Meerkat, I'll schedule it. I'll schedule an event probably Friday night. I'll schedule it Friday night. You'll be able to see it. It's 9 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. Meerkat, thank you guys so much. You can like this show. You can retweet this show. You can even save the show, and you can watch it all over again. I really, really appreciate all you guys on Meerkat. I want you to know it's a new platform for me. I'm really loving the camaraderie, and I'm really loving all you folks following me. I want you to know I'm madly in love with you. It means a lot. It really means a lot. And he says, good, ban the idiots. He said, so if a dog cries when you use the e-cow but still doesn't stop the behavior, it's not a hard enough correction. What do you mean by cries? Nikki, help me out. What do you mean by cries? Like screams? Because the dog might not know what you're talking about. It might be miscommunication. So what I'm not doing, I'm not saying just for every bad thing the dog does, you use the remote. Because we use the remote for a ton of good stuff too. So help me out. I'll stick around for a couple more minutes. Tell me what you mean by cries. Because I've never heard a dog cry. If you're talking like a scream, they just might not know what to do What you have to do is you have to go back to the leash. So you might have to guide the dog. So you might have to guide the dog somewhere because he might be confused. Yelps. Oh, yelps, yeah. I have dogs yelp at 4. So the remote collar goes from 0 to 100 that I use. At a 4, the dog yelps. Oh! It still does it. It all depends. Put it in the scale for me, Nikki, so I don't give you an irresponsible answer. Like, what's the dog doing that you're trying to stop? What's the dog doing that you're trying to stop? People go to rvdogtrainer.com, RV Dog Training. So she's being dog reactive. Dial it up and she yelps. Dial it up more. Dial it up more. Yes. Yep. Yep. Linnea says, thank you, Jeff. See you on Monday. You can see me on Saturday. I'm around. Where are you going to be, Linnea? On Meerkat. Where are you going to be? All these shows are available on YouTube. Just to let folks know, if you miss any part of this show, it's on YouTube. Nikki says she's barking at other dogs. Yeah, if the dog keeps barking at other dogs, correct, you got to go higher. You got to go higher. Yep, absolutely. Absolutely. Nina says, one last thing about finding the working level for my dog. I tried a second time in a quiet room, no distractions, but then she seemed to hear the clicking of the double tap. I know, that's the problem. So she's medium length cattle dog here. Try the longer, so Nina, try the longer prongs, okay? Try the longer prongs, all right? Try the longer prongs. And go up higher. Go up higher and see. Go up to 30 and see if the dog even moves. So if you go up to 30, and then next thing you know, you might be down to 15, okay? Hold on, now we got a ton of onslaught questions. Onslaught questions. Hold on, guys. Okay, I'm trying to get in the bed with my wife here. Okay, she goes to sleep. I got 15 minutes. 15 minutes. That's it. That's it. No more sex for the night. Michelle says, wouldn't the yelp indicate it's too high? No, not at all. Yelp just indicates that you startled the dog. This is the thing. When you're trying to correct an unwanted behavior, here's a good idea. Here's a great example of going up high on the remote. Dog is in a trash can, okay? Dog could die from getting something out of a trash can. Plus a dog, you could get injured trying to get something out of the mouth of a dog at the trash can. How about this? Dog's in a great example, because this is what we do. Dog's in a trash can, you take the remote, your working level is an 8, you turn it up to 20. You hit the button, the dog yelps, still goes back in the trash can. Turn it up to 30, boom, dog yelps, still goes back in the trash can. Hit up to 50, boom, dog yelps, walks away. 50 is the number. 50 is the number. Let the always listen to the dog. Always listen to the dog, okay? Always listen to the dog. Claire, coming in very late. Claire, you're coming in at the end of the show. It's 10:18. I was almost off the air. I wanted to say thanks to you for helping me with my young lab who was recently accepted into a service dog program for veterans with post-traumatic stress disorder. Oh, my gosh, congratulations. You and a few other trainers helped me train him. You helped me a lot. Claire, you're awesome. I'm so proud of you. Thank you so much. But it doesn't – that's not a good enough excuse for coming in late. Don't ever do that again. All right? Thank you in all capitals. I love you in all capitals, Nikki. All right, guys. I can hear my wife now. Brian says, thank you for everything, Jeff. We can finally see the light at the end of the tunnel. Yes. Hopefully you'll get to see more calm and different Bruno by the next RV seminar. So, folks, so Brian and his lovely wife, are you guys married? It was your wife, your partner, your girlfriend, but she was lovely. Brian and his lovely partner were the ones with a white Dogo Argentino at the seminar. And you know, if you think the dog was there for 2 days, but if you think about it, I only worked with a dog for maybe half an hour. And we got, when Brian got home, he saw a much, much different energy on the dog. Much, much better energy on that dog. I'm telling you. I am telling you. We're getting some dramatic results, some dramatic, dramatic results with the work we're doing. We're getting dramatic results. I want you to know that you know, I'll probably do this on Meerkat. I'm gonna probably start doing some of my training sessions live on Meerkat, all right? I put up a lot of videos, but none of them are live streaming. So we might do something on Meerkat, okay? Michelle says, Bruno, was that the name of the dog? The white dogo, Bruno? I think I forgot the names of all these dogs. All right, guys, madly in love with you. Lenny says, thank you, Jeff. See you on Saturday. Awesome. Can't wait to see you. Meerkat, you guys are great. That's the most people. It's not a ton of people. 41 people are here. 309 people saw the show at some point. That's great, guys. I love you guys. I love you guys on Meerkat. Rhonda says, this is exactly what I need, better energy for my dog. Listen to me, you'll get it. Live stream it. We have to be careful about live stream. Sammy, the entire RV on Meerkat? Maybe. You know what? I can probably do a Meerkat from the RV. My RV's in the shop right now. The damn RV. You know, you don't get an RV. I shouldn't complain. You don't get an RV to save money. You don't get an RV to save money. That's for sure. So I've got, I needed all new front brakes, front rotors. Oh, geez, the whole front end I had to get redone. And then what else in the RV? I had some electrical issues I had to fix. I had a new converter put in, and it was drawing down from the inverter. There's all kinds of stuff. And then I've got I got a leak. I got a leak in the roof. I got to fix this leak in the roof. But I love that RV. I love that RV. Michelle says, "Go to bed. Stop telling me what to do, Michelle." Sean and Amy. Thank you. You're welcome. Michelle's truly impressed. Yeah, that was impressive. All right. All right, guys. Let me get out of here. Okay. Madly in love with you guys. Meerkat, awesome. Love you guys.